So once again, greetings and welcome to the Terraform webinar. I hope I am loud and clear audible to everyone. Please give me a quick confirmation. So let's move ahead without wasting any further time. So let me first of all introduce myself. So my name is Anshu Kumar, and currently I am associated with Koenig Solutions as a corporate trainer. Talking about my technical acquaintances, I am a Microsoft certified trainer as well as a Red Hat certified instructor. And I am a Red Hat certified engineer along with system administrator. I also have expertise into my DevOps domain, where I am a Terraform associate as well as a certified Kubernetes administrator. Talking about my experience, I have more than 6 years of corporate training experience, where I have delivered most of my trainings for the organizations which are working on very different projects. So let's talk about the agenda, what we are going to discuss about this in this Terraform webinar. So first of all, we will discuss about that, what are the different challenges, what are the different reasons that we are going to discuss about these infrastructure as a code tools. Then we will talk about what are the different infrastructure as a code tools. So we will see that in market, what are the most popular and commonly used different IAC tools. Then coming to our topic, we will discuss about Terraform. We will talk that from where Terraform started and how it is now into the market and what actually is Terraform. We will talk about that. And then for understanding it more better, we will have a quick comparison between Ansible and Terraform, so that all of you get to understand that why Terraform is different from Ansible and why, in spite of having tools like Ansible in the market, we are now moving towards Terraform also. After understanding about the Terraform and the need of Terraform, we will dive deeper into the Terraform lifecycle. We will discuss about the complete lifecycle of the resources creation in your Terraform using different resource types. And then most important, since it is completely still evolving in the market and there are many people who are interested to learn this, and it's very interesting part that Terraform is very easy to learn. It has a very fast learning curve. So we will talk about that as a beginner, how I can start learning Terraform. So the best thing is to discuss about the documentation, that how basically you can use the Terraform documentation to be more efficient when you are creating your resources. And at the end, I will be demonstrating a quick infrastructure provisioning on one of the resource providers using Terraform. So this is the agenda that we are going to take ahead in this webinar. So let's get started with the first topic for this, that is what challenges we are facing currently when we are working in different sectors of our different industries. Okay, so some of them I have mentioned on this slide. While there are many challenges, I have tried to summarize them into very small and most, I should say, the challenges which are faced by almost every engineer who is working into the DevOps industry or into automation industry. So initially, if you talk about the managers, the IT managers, what they had to do is they had to manually install the servers. Okay. And after installing, they have to manually configure them and deliver all the programs to them. So everything was manual. Even if you have development team or networking teams, so the networking teams manually stores and handles your all the configuration data. So this entire process was very time consuming and a tedious process. Okay, and not only time consuming and tedious, also different team collaboration was needed for successful deployment. Okay, so that was the first challenge which I felt that this is something which most of the IT people are facing. Apart from that, second one I have highlighted here is the scalability. So another challenge that comes is about scaling your resources. Okay, so administrators were struggling to bring up your new servers, your new machines very fast, which will try to keep up with the speed and scope of the changing business operations. And to do that, it's not just that you quickly scale up your resources. You also have to have more manpower. So you hire and manage more team, which significantly added to the costing. So that was another challenge that the companies were facing. Although I am sure that most of you here must have encountered that some of the companies have tried to solve this problem by deploying their resources on cloud. So they have tried to deploy on multi-cloud also, not only on one cloud. So they have tried to use the multi-cloud and hybrid cloud installations. But in that also, there is a problem. Problem is managing the services individually for respective cloud services. Because let's say if I am having knowledge of working on AWS, I might not be familiar with Azure. I might not be familiar with GCP, DigitalOcean, and etc. So I need different individuals, those who are going to manage the respective services for me on the respective cloud services. Another, the most important thing is about maintaining your infrastructure state. That was another challenge. So now what I have seen mostly in industry happening is people are automating their processes. So they are automating the process using some scripts. So using those automation scripts, they are trying to manage the infrastructure. But the challenge in that is the state management. So the state management becomes a very, again, hectic task when we use the automation things. So all these problems, you know, they have solutions now, like the administrators may not, you know, manually do all the things. What they can do is they can set a configuration. So they can have a predefined configurations for their infrastructure and maybe for individual resources also. And using those configurations, they can automate the infrastructure using the platforms that we call as IAC, infrastructure as a code. Okay, so that is why nowadays we are more interested towards learning infrastructure as a code tools. And this webinar is based upon one of those tools that we are going to talk about is Terraform. I'm sure that you must be having questions when I'm discussing anything or when I'm sharing something about a particular topic. I'll request you to hold the questions, and at the end of the webinar, I'll definitely have a quick question session where we can discuss our doubts. Moving ahead, now when we talk about the tools. So as I told that in the market, we have different infrastructure as a code tools. Some of them I have listed in this slide here. Apart from this, there are many more, but I have tried to use, again, those tools which are very popular. So starting from the very first one, that is Ansible. So Red Hat actually developed Ansible. So this is a product of Red Hat. And this is considered to be the most simplest, I should say, tool to automate your provisioning and configuration management of your applications. So if I'm an Ansible user, I am executing the playbooks. And those playbooks are creating and managing the infrastructure resources for me. And you know that Ansible does not use the agents. So you can connect to servers and you can run the commands over your SSH connections. So you write all your code into YAML. So your YAML syntax is used in your playbooks, which always makes it very easy to understand and deploy your configurations. Then we have another one called AWS CloudFormation. So those of you here who must be familiar with AWS CSP, you know that AWS provides you a very easy way to quickly and efficiently provision your multiple, you know, resources, which are from AWS as well as from third party also. So this AWS CloudFormation basically helps you to manage and scale your resources. And along with management and scaling, you can even automate your resource management by integrating your CloudFormation with different resources. Okay, so just like Ansible, your CloudFormation are also written in YAML format or JSON format can also be said. Okay, so this one is basically designed by Amazon. Then the third one we have is Azure Resource Manager, ARM. So this is another service which is provided by Microsoft. Okay, and this is used for developing and managing your Azure resources. Okay, so it's a tool which we use only for Azure, and it allows you to deploy, to maintain your, you know, resources in a collection or individually also. And the best part in Azure Resource Manager is you can incorporate role-based access controls. So you have this mechanism in which you can allow the users to access only those resources which comes under their job category. So that is your arm. Then you have GC deploy management, Google Cloud Deployment Manager. So this is another IAC tool that is developed by, of course, Google. And this is also used to automate and, you know, automate the creation, automate the configuration, the provisioning, and the management of resources on Google Cloud platform, on GCP. Okay, so using this deployment manager, you can easily create your resources and manage them as a single unit. And here also, you can use YAML as well as Python also. So you can build your models using YAML or Python, and you can deploy them and you can see them. So these are from different Ansible from Red Hat, AWS from Amazon, Azure from Microsoft, and Google Cloud Deployment Manager comes from Google. So these are the major giants in the market. Apart from this, there are some tools you must have heard about, like Chef. Chef is one of the most notable IaaS tools in industry. Okay, it is just like Ansible, but basically it is an agent-based tool. So in Ansible, we call it as agentless. You don't need to install the agents on your machines which you are trying to manage on your node, manage nodes. In Chef, you must have installed on both of them. So basically, this Chef uses the recipes and cookbooks. Okay. And using those recipes and cookbooks, you specify that what are the exact steps that you need to require to achieve your configuration. So it's a little bit different. It is basically, we have a procedural style language when we use Chef, okay? And similar to that, we have Puppet also. Puppet is also another open source configuration management tool. Chef is also your open source management tool, okay? As well as Puppet. Now, Puppet is also most commonly used, but the difference between Chef and Puppet is Chef uses a declarative approach and Puppet goes with your procedural approach. Okay, so when you have to decide that which configuration will decide what step, so for that you will use Chef. For Puppet, you can directly define your resources. And then comes the last but the most important that we're going to talk about is Terraform. So Terraform, created by HashiCorp, is one of the most popular and open source tool which is used for infrastructure automation. It helps in configuring and provisioning your infrastructure as a code. So using Terraform, you can easily plan and create your infrastructure across multiple providers. That's the benefit. Till now, I was saying AWS, that means CloudFormation on AWS, Azure only on Microsoft Azure, Google Cloud Deployment Manager only on GCP. But with Terraform, I can easily plan and create my resources across multiple providers with a single same workflow. Okay. And it also uses a declarative approach. So you define your exact requirement as a code and you can provision your resources directly. Okay. So it reduces human errors and increases your automation in the infrastructure provisioning. So the question is, how do you choose the best IAC tools out of these? Well, I will, of course, talk about Terraform because of this webinar, but still, in general, if you think of it, that how do you choose about the best IAC tools out of these? So there are different tools that can, you know, be used in different scenarios. So all these tools which you have right now in this slide will perform different tasks. And all of them cannot do the same tasks. Okay. For example, if you talk about configuration management versus provisioning, okay, so Ansible, Chef, Puppet, these all are the configuration management tools, which are basically used to install and then configure your applications on your infrastructure. So you can create an infrastructure and you can configure your, you know, applications on them, or you can also configure applications on existing infrastructure using tools like Ansible, Chef, and Puppet. Whereas if you talk about Terraform, tools like Terraform or CloudFormation or Google Cloud Deployment Manager, these are basically infrastructure provisioning tools. Okay, so they are basically used to provision your servers, your infrastructures like load balancers, databases, network configurations. Okay, so they are basically focused towards provisioning, and tools like Ansible, Chef, and Puppet, they are focused towards configuration management. Why? Just want to highlight, Terraform can do both infrastructure provisioning as well as your application deployment also. That's why I'll say the Terraform is the best of all these tools to start with, and you start learning about Terraform. Okay, so that was a quick brief intro about the most popular infrastructure as a code tools. I'm sure that all of you here must be familiar with any one of them. And now after this webinar, you must carry some knowledge at least about each one of these IA tools. Now let's start with our main IA tool that we will talk about is Terraform. So what is Terraform? Just now I talked a lot about Terraform. Now let me highlight some more things. So Terraform basically, as I told you, is an open source infrastructure as a code tool, and it is developed by HashiCorp. Okay, so you use Terraform to define and provision your complete infrastructure using your configuration, which is based upon declarative language. Okay, so just now I told you that Terraform is an infrastructure provisioning tool. So you can store your entire infrastructure as a code. So it's a very similar tool, just like as CloudFormation. But the difference is, using CloudFormation, you will automate your infrastructure only on AWS. But using Terraform, you can do it on other cloud platforms as well. Okay, so Terraform basically let you define. One more thing I would like to add here. I have seen many people, those who are new to Terraform, they have this thing in mind that Terraform is a IA tool that let you define resources on cloud only. No, Terraform also let you define your resources on cloud as well as on-prem resources also. Okay, so you can have your configuration files, and with that configuration file, you can create your resources on both on cloud as well as on-prem also. You might have heard about Vagrant. That's another product of HashiCorp, using which we do that. Okay. Now, the question is how Terraform, you know, creates and manages resources on my resource provider. So Terraform does this using APIs, using your application programming interface. Okay. And just to add on, let me quickly show you something on the registry terraform.io. which is the official page of Terraform HashiCorp. Terraform has added more than 1900 providers. I know on my fingers mostly 8 to 10 providers. Like just now we talked AWS, GCP, Azure, Kubernetes, DigitalOcean. Hardly 2 or 3 more I can count if I give the strength of my memory. But you see, Terraform has more than 1900 providers, which you can manage single-handedly in a single workflow using Terraform. That's the beauty of Terraform. Okay. And HashiCorp and Terraform community, both of them have written these providers to manage your resources and services. And continuously it is growing. Today it is 1961. Tomorrow evening you check, it will go to 62, 63, and so on. Every day I notice they keep on adding 2 or 3 providers. And you can find all of them, all the providers. Maybe it is from your company also. You can find all the providers here. Okay, you can simply check it and you can see the list of all the providers. These are the most common and most, I should say, popular: AWS, Azure, GCP, Kubernetes, Alibaba. And there are different types of category based upon which you can filter also. If you want to see your providers only from database, you can go from database and see. So you have verified from Astra, ElasticStack, Mongo for Redis Cloud. There are community contributions also like Cassandra, Cockroach, Couchbase, Elasticsearch, and EDC. So it's a very addictive, I'll tell you, very addictive technology when you start learning about Terraform. Because since when I started, I have been so much addicted to this that I am starting diving more and more deep to understand that how Terraform can help me to do this. Okay. Now let's talk about a quick comparison of Ansible and Terraform. Already I have told you that Ansible means we are more focused towards configuration management. And Terraform means we are more focused towards provisioning. So Terraform is a provisioning tool and Ansible is a configuration management tool. So if you simply, you know, talk about the percentage, Ansible has more of the focus, 90% I should say, towards configuration management and 10% towards provisioning. So you will get more features towards configuration management and you will get less, you know, yeah, there are some features for provisioning that of course you can use. While Terraform, 90% ratio is towards provisioning and 10% is towards configuration management. Yes, there are some things, as I told you, that you can do with Terraform also after your resources are created. Okay, but if you talk about the use case, Terraform is basically focused on your infrastructure provisioning and Ansible is basically focused to deploy and for configuration of your machines. So that is the basic difference. But the catch is not only it helps you to, you know, provision infrastructure or manage infrastructures, you should always integrate Ansible and Terraform together, or tools like configuration management and provisioning infrastructure tools together. Why? Because one will help you to provision infrastructure, and after provisioning, the other tool will help you to manage your infrastructure. Okay, so they always work hand in hand. So we say that Ansible and Terraform, they both are friends. They both should be kept together so that you get a good, more productive and more efficient environment. Okay. So this was up to here. We discussed about what is Terraform, how we compare it with Terraform, with Ansible and different tools. Now the question is how Terraform works in the backend. Okay, what happens? So in this slide, you are seeing there are some images. So let's say that you are a user and you wrote some configuration. For example, you want to deploy a virtual machine. So in your configuration.tf file, so Terraform files will always end with .tf, any name .tf, and also .tf.json. Sometimes you will also see the file ending with .tf.json. Okay. Now here I defined that in my VM what I need. I defined everything. Then I gave this file to Terraform. Okay. The moment I gave this file to Terraform, Terraform through API connected to my resource provider. Okay. Of course, which resource provider I want to connect, I will mention this in my configuration, whether I want to connect to Azure or I want to connect to GCP or I want to connect to Alibaba and so on. I will mention these details here. So Terraform will pick up the detail for resource provider first, and using API, it will connect to my resource provider and will start provisioning my infrastructure here. Okay, so let's say it's on AWS or on Azure or on GCP or in DigitalOcean. So let's say that on my AWS, my EC2 instance has been created, or on Azure, my virtual machine has been created with this configuration file. Okay, now after your resource has been created, Terraform is very smart. What Terraform does, it stores your infrastructure information into a file called tfstate. This is called Terraform state file. Okay, so in my next slide, when I will talk about the life cycle of Terraform, there you will see that how Terraform basically uses this TF state file to speed up your process of provisioning infrastructure or comparing your desired infrastructure with the current infrastructure on your resource provider. Okay, so once you build your infrastructure, Terraform locally stores your infrastructure information into .tf state file. Okay, and you can use this .tf state file for, you know, for versioning, for reusing it to maintain your infrastructure versions for stability, so that in future, if you want to roll back to any specific version, you can go to that. Okay, so this is how Terraform works. First, we will start writing our Terraform configuration file. Here you can use any editor to define. You can use Notepad, Notepad++, VS Code, anything, Anaconda, Jupyter, anything will be fine. Use your editor, define your .tf files. Then, of course, you should have Terraform installed. Using that Terraform, you will pass that file, and Terraform will take all your configurations, connect through API to your resource provider, and will deploy your infrastructure. Okay, and after deployment, it will also create a TF state file locally on your machine where it will store your infrastructure information. So in production environment, as a good habit, we don't give access of TF state files to all the users because it contains the confidential information about my infrastructure. So we always try to keep it with very restricted permissions, okay? So that only the authorized person should have the access of read or write to this TF state files. Although Terraform says that you should not manually modify this file. You should not manually modify. Only Terraform will modify that file for you. Whenever you deploy your infrastructure, whenever you destroy your infrastructure, whenever you modify your infrastructure, in all these cases, your TF state file will be updated. Okay, so this is how Terraform works in the backend. Now, let's talk about the lifecycle. That this is the most important thing, that how Terraform works. Okay, so this is the code which I am going to write. My first .tf file. Okay, so I wrote, for example, I'm going to deploy a VM. So vm.tf. So I have vm.tf file. In this, I will deploy all the details of my infrastructure, entire thing. Now, this code, the first thing after defining your Terraform, the first command that you do is you run your Terraform init. Now, what init will do? Init will download. It will download what? Your resource provider. Your resource provider. This is only a one-time task. The first time when you are using your provider, unless you upgrade your provider. So whatever provider you have mentioned at the top of your configuration, that provider will be locally downloaded in your system. I'll show you that live also. Once you have got your resource provider, then you have another command. So this is the first command, step number one. You have done download init. So init will download your resource provider. After this, you run another command, step number two, called plan. What is plan? Plan is like a dry run. Those who know about Ansible or other tools, we have a dry run. In this plan, what Terraform does is, Terraform checks your current state and your desired state. Okay, your current state and your desired state. Current state means the state of your infrastructure on your resource provider. For example, you said that I want to deploy a VM. So when you will do a plan, Terraform will check whether this VM exists or not. So that is your current state. If it is not existing, then what is your desired state? You want this VM to be deployed with these following configurations. So Terraform will always do a comparison of your current state and your desired state. And based upon the comparison, it will propose the plans that, for example, let's say your VM is not created. So when you are creating your VM, let's say you are creating it on Azure. So you will be creating resource groups. You will be creating networkings, virtual networks, network interface, subnets. You will be creating a virtual machine. So different resource type you will define. So those resources, it will propose that boss two plans to add. Two plans means two resource types will be added. Okay, if there is something to be modified, for example, already a VM is running, but you are changing the VM name, you are changing the VM location, you are changing the size of VM, any changes, you're modifying it. So in that case, it will say two plans to modify or three plans to modify. Okay, if you are saying I don't want VM, so it will say plans to destroy. So you get plans to add, plans to modify, and plans to destroy. This message will be available on the terminal when you run Terraform plan command. And how it does that? It actually checks your current state and desired state using your API. It connects to the resource provider, and then it checks and tell you that what will be the proposed changes. It will not do the changes, okay? It will just tell you that, boss, these changes are going to happen. So, of course, you will get a confirmation that, okay, everything looks good. I will get my resources created and blah, 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 all the attributes and different arguments. Then what you will do? You will do one syntax check. This is called a syntax check, a validation. For this, we have a command called Terraform validate. Terraform validate. Okay, so you can run this command before plan also, after plan, totally your call how you want to do it. So this plan will simply check whether your syntax are correct or not, if there's any syntax error. If everything is correct, this will give you a message that your configuration is successful. You can move ahead. You will get a success confirmation and then you can go for apply. Apply means the final step, step number four, that you are going to provision your infrastructure. So this apply will connect to your resource provider and will execute all these plans and your resource will start creating. Okay. And after creating apply, when you have created resources, it will create which file? .tfstate file. This will store all the information of your infrastructure that has been created. For example, if VM has been created, the name of VM, the IP of VM, the every details of VM will be stored, the image, the size, the RAM, the CPU, the networking details, the storage details, all the details will be stored in your file called tfstate. Okay. And after that, again, if you want, you can destroy it. After apply, if you see that, okay, everything is fine, now I need to destroy my resources. So you can run the command Terraform destroy. Simple command, you say Terraform destroy. If you say Terraform destroy, it will destroy all the resources, okay, in their complete configuration. Everything will be destroyed. And this process cannot be undone. Okay, it's not possible to undo that. So you have to be very careful when you are destroying your resources. Now, there is also a chance that you don't want to destroy all the resources. Maybe you want to destroy the VM, but you want to keep the public IP. You want to keep the storage accounts. Okay. So in that case, you can specifically target that which particular resource you want to delete or you want to destroy. So with that, we use a flag called hyphen target. Okay. And then we specify that which flag we have to destroy or which resource we have to destroy. So then Terraform will not destroy all the resources. Okay. And then later on, you can again reuse your same code and you can maintain your different versions by doing small modifications. So this is the complete life cycle that how your Terraform is going to work. Okay. So basically you write your code, download a resource provider, check for the proposed plans, and then you apply and provision your infrastructure. Okay, so this is a complete process. Now, very important thing that I would like to highlight here that should be noticed when you are talking about creating of resources. Okay, the first thing is it is working on the directory level. Okay, so all your Terraform resources that you have created. So for example, this is one folder in which I have multiple Terraform files. So if I have multiple Terraform files, it will check for all the configurations. Okay, so you have to be very careful that if you are doing a destroy and if there are two or three different .tf files, Terraform will destroy all those resources. So it's a very good habit to always destroy the resources with a target flag so that you'll be very specific that which particular resource you want to destroy. Okay, because Terraform checks for the configuration files in your current working directory. If there are two configuration files, it will delete all the resources of that configuration. And the same happens when you do an apply also. Okay, so if you are doing an apply and there are different configurations defined in two different .tf files, Terraform will consider both of them. Okay, and the order of defining your resources does not matter because it's a declarative approach. So your resources will be created, but there are tools like Terraform Graph, which can help you to visualize that how my resources were created. Okay, so that was about Terraform lifecycle. Now, I have told a lot about different commands and different way of creating a resources. Let me quickly demonstrate that how these resources are created. Okay, so I will be demonstrating it on Azure, Microsoft Azure, and it will be almost similar for any of the resources that you are using. Okay, so I will demonstrate it for Microsoft Azure. So how we basically use it, that's the main question with documentation, okay? So Terraform documentation I'm going to cover in my demo only. So I have a requirement. I want to create a virtual machine. I'm new. I don't know how to create a virtual machine. I will start exploring the documentation. So documentations are available on this link. I'll share the link in the chat also for your reference. So we have a couple of questions in the chat. Yes, I'm going to show some sample demo, which I'm going to start now. Okay, and I've shared the link for the Terraform registry also. So from here, let's go to the providers. As I told you that I'm going to use Azure. So I'm going to use Microsoft Azure. And here, how I will use this. So to create, I have a Visual Studio Code Editor. I'm going to create here. I'll create a new file in my folder called TF Demo. Let's give the file name as, for example, myvm.tf. Okay, myvm.terraform. Now, I have some extensions installed due to which you can see that it will give me an auto-completing features. I want to create a resource. So the first information I have to define is my provider information, okay? So from the documentation, I can see how to use the providers. So they have given here that this is the format that you will use the provider. I'll not explain this because this is the part which we need time to understand. I'll just paste the provider information here. I will explain the process, okay, that how the resources are created, because it's a webinar where we have limited time. So I'm not going to talk about the resource types and blocks. I want you to understand the process of creating an infrastructure using Terraform. So let's say this is the information which I'm going to use to connect to my provider. So this information will define that I am going to use Azure provider. Okay, the name of Azure provider is Azure RM that you can see on the documentation. This is the name of provider. Similarly, if you see other providers like AWS, they have the name AWS. If you see for Google Cloud Platform, they have the name as Google. Similarly for Azure, it is Azure RM. Okay. I want to deploy a virtual machine. How to do it? Go to documentation. Okay. And this is the documentation which you should always refer whenever you are looking for any thing. Okay. Anything. You should not go to any other place. This is the most authentic and latest information on Terraform. Terraform community keeps on updating the documentation also. As you can see right now, it is on the latest version. You can go to the documentations of any previous version. And these documents are specific to the resource providers, okay? Right now, currently, I am exploring the documentation for Azure. You can do the same way for different resource providers also. Okay, so here are many different provider sources. My intention right now is to create a virtual machine, so I will start searching here. So let's say I want to create a Windows virtual machine. So I will say Windows virtual machine. And I have got the results. Let's go to one of them. So this is my resource type, Windows virtual machine of my resource provider Azure RM. So here I have the example. So I will take the example, okay? And then I will explain you what is happening in the example. Okay, I'll copy this example and I will put it on the VS Code. Now let's take it from the top. The first thing is your provider information that I manually wrote. After that, the next is resource. Now see, we have resource block. These are the blocks that means these resources will be created. We have different blocks like modules, variables, providers, outputs. There are many different blocks which you will see when you start learning Terraform in detail. So resource block means you are creating a resource, okay? And this is the resource type. You know, the first logical resource that you create in Azure is resource group, okay? So this is creating a resource group with the name called example resource. Let's change this name to Terraform Webinar RG, okay? And let's deploy this, let's say in East US. You can use any location. Fine, this looks good. Then I have a virtual network. Of course, we need a virtual network to attach to our machine. Virtual network goes with this name, with this default address space. I'm okay with that. Then we have a subnet with the default name and default values. I'm okay with that also. You can specify your own subnets, your own virtual networks, you know, networking range. That's totally your call. Then there's a network interface that is also defined, and you have an IP defined in network interface. Okay. Then you have your virtual machine, where you have the virtual machine name. So let me give this virtual machine name as Terraform VM. Okay. Then this is using this credential, admin user. Let me change this to name called Anshu, and I will go with the same password, no problem. Then this is attaching my network interface to my virtual machine. Of course, I need a network interface to attach so that I get my MAC address and other things. So I'm attaching my network interface to my machine. And then these are the details for my operating system. I'm using a Windows image with 2016 image, version latest. And storage account that I'm creating is locally redundant LRS. Okay. All these things will vary depending upon your need. This is just one example, but always you will start taking the examples from documentation and then change all these parameters and attributes according to your need. Okay. Perfect. Looks good to me. But one thing which I can see here is how will my VM get my IP address? Once my VM is created, how will I get the IP address? Because IP address is not created here. There is no IP address. Okay. So let me quickly attach a public IP address to this. Again, from documentation, I will search for a public IP. And this is my public IP. And this is the way of creating a public IP. This is not mandatory. It is only mandatory if you want to access your VM with a public IP address. So I am creating it. I can show you a demo. So I can paste it anywhere. Let's paste it before virtual net. So now my public IP is created. Cool. I want to attach this public IP to my network interface. Okay. So I will attach this here in my network interface. Public underscore IP underscore ID with my resource type that comes from Azure RM underscore public underscore IP dot local name dot ID. Now, why I did this and everything is a part of understanding the concept. I would not like to, you know, go deep into this right now in this webinar. This is just to attach my public IP to my network interface. Okay, looks good now. Now let's go and follow the process, life cycle, plan, init, and all those things. My configuration is ready. I'm in a directory. I told you what will the first step. The first step will be for downloading your resource provider, correct? So if I show you my file explorer, you see on my desktop, I have this TF demo, which is empty. Only a Terraform file is there. Now I'm going to download my resource provider. What's the command I told you? Terraform init. Okay. The moment I hit enter, it will start downloading the resource provider. You see Azure RM because of this line that I have defined here, Azure RM. And by default, it's taking the latest version 3.0.2. Okay. Let's wait for it to download the resource provider. It hardly takes a couple of seconds. Now you see, I got a .terraform directory as well as .terraform.log.hcl file. I will not talk about log file. I will talk about this folder. If you see this folder, .terraform, here you have your provider information, which you just downloaded from Azure, the version of that. And this is the file, the API that will be used to connect with the provider. Okay, fine. My initialization is done. Next command I told in lifecycle is to do a plan. So let me show you the plan. Terraform plan. What plan will do? Plan will check whether this VM exists on my resource provider or not. Sorry for this typos, T-A-R-R-A. Okay. So right now you can see on my Azure portal, I only have one virtual machine, which currently I am using with the name called WinTF, but we are creating a new virtual machine with the name called, I think we gave a different name. The name was TF underscore VM. So let's wait for it to propose the plans. Amar, I have shared the link of registry above in the chat. You can please take a reference from that. Okay, perfect. You see, it says six plans to add. What are the six plans? I'll show you from the top. So one is network interface. Then you have your public IP, two. Then you have resource group, three. Then you have subnet, four. Virtual network, five. and you have your Windows virtual machine. So there are six resources that will be created now. And that's what it is saying, that six plans will be added. You see, if you don't have TF state file till now. Now I will do, okay, everything looks good. Let's do an apply. Terraform apply. So now it will start creating these resources. Let's wait for it. So it's asking me, do you want to confirm? Yes, I want to confirm. You can also use auto approve option in your CI/CD process. If you have a CI/CD integration there, you will not be prompted for anything. So you can use auto approve flag, which will automatically approve your provisioning of infrastructure. Okay, so you can see now it's creating. First, it created resource group, then network, then public IP, then virtual network, subnet. Okay, now there is an error with the computer name. It says that your computer name is very big. Please adjust the characters. You can't use underscore in the names. Okay, save it and then run it again. So there are some different guidelines and rules for, like, you know, for password, we have uppercase, lowercase. Similarly, for virtual machine names also, you can't use special characters. Okay, so that's why I got an error. No worries. It will start creating only those resources which were not created. So you see, now I'm getting only one plan to add. Why? Because all five are created, only Windows machine got an error. I say, okay, start. So directly we'll start creating a virtual machine now. So virtual machine creating, it might take a minute to do, because you know that on cloud providers, sometimes creation of VM takes time. Let's wait. Still creating. And it says, apply complete, resource has been added. So what's my VM name? My VM name is Terraform VM, TF VM, in which location it has gone in East US under this resource group. Let's verify. Let's come to Azure. Let's refresh. And you see TF VM. This VM is up. Status is creating. Let's refresh again. It will show me status running. And here it is. TF VM is running now. Now I can go there. I can use this normal VM. I have my public IP attached. I have my virtual network. Everything looks good. I can just download the RDP file and I can connect to that RDP. I'll show you that also. Let me just connect the RDP. Connect. And I give the username as Anshu. And password I will copy and paste, because print password. So I'll copy paste this password there. So yes, certificates, that means it is successfully connecting. And here you go. My Windows has started. Okay, so that was how you can create your resources on your any resource provider. I showed you on Azure using Terraform. So the same workflow you use for different resource providers. Okay, so that was a quick demonstration about resources. Now, another 5 minutes, I'm open to any questions. If you have, you can put in the chat. I will be happy to answer them before we move towards the end of our webinar. I'll appreciate a couple of questions if you have. Any online resources to learn Terraform? Documentation, Rohit, please refer documentation. That's the best resource I can tell. Okay. Amar, to change the configuration, again, you will go to the same .tf file, do all the changes and apply again. Your Terraform will modify the configuration for you. Okay, you can't do anything post deployment. For that, you will have to use configuration management tools like Ansible. Okay, but if you want to change the configurations of your VM, then you change the details, apply it again. Terraform will try to match your desired and current state. Mohanty, it depends. Like I use the subnets and virtual networks. If you have your firewalls, you should create your network security groups. Your NSG should be created and you should define your inbound and outbound rules. Okay. And then you can overpass those challenges also. Okay. So you have the option of creating your network security groups also. CI/CD is meant for Terraform. I didn't say that CI/CD is not meant for Terraform. I said that there is a Terraform cloud version of Terraform, which is mainly made for CI/CD process only. You can use it with VCS tools like GitHub and others. Okay. So if you heard it, there was a communication gap. CI/CD will be used with Terraform. Ashok, as I told you, Terraform is more towards infrastructure provisioning. Okay, not towards the management of the infrastructure. There are up to some features that you can handle, but not up to the advanced features that you can do with other configuration management tools. Okay, good to see questions getting fired up. Perfect. So on that note, we have one more question. Is Terraform available for VMware? So yes, Antonio, as I told you, Terraform is available for both cloud as well as on-prem. So you can also use it for VMware providers also. You can select your tenant. Nagalakshmi, what you can do is when you are authenticating with Azure, you can use the tenant ID to log into a particular subscription or to a particular tenant. Okay, so that is a part of authentication. Okay, so on that note, that will be all from my end for this Terraform. I hope all of you got a good idea about what Terraform is and also the comparison of Terraform with other infrastructure as a code tools. So thank you all so much for joining this webinar, and I wish you all the best for keep learning new technologies, and happy learning, everyone. And please do share your presence in the session by giving a feedback on the link given in the chat from Ram. Okay. And that feedback will help us to encourage and get motivated with more sessions like this for you.